our third session, and in our last two sessions we discussed about the basics of what exactly is SAP, what exactly is SAP S/4HANA, right? We understood the history of SAP S/4HANA, how it started, what are the different versions available in the market as of today. And what we are going to do from today is we are going to concentrate on our core topic, that is SAP S/4HANA Finance, right? So we already know the basics of SAP and basics of SAP S/4HANA. And what we are starting from today is understanding how financial accounting works in SAP S/4HANA. Okay, before I go to that financial accounting in SAP S/4HANA, I would like to show you the, there is some background noise. Please mute yourself, all of you. Yeah. So before I go to the financial accounting in SAP S/4HANA, I would like to give you the quick glimpse of how exactly SAP screens looks like, what are the different things that you can do in SAP, and then we'll start with the financial accounting. So even either today or tomorrow, I'll be arranging your server access also so that you can also start whatever we are doing in the session, you also perform the same. You can practice on your own and come up with your doubts. So once you get the server access, you would be able to see this SAP logon pad, right? The steps and all will be mentioned in the mail, which you will be getting. Once you get that mail, you will be connecting to this particular screen. And in this screen, you will be able to see this SAP logon, right? When you're working on the projects, your company will provide you these details. They will install SAP logon in your system. Okay. And if you are not able to see SAP logon in your system, you have to request within your company to provide this particular software in order to use it. So this SAP logon is a login screen, which allows you to connect to different SAP systems. Okay. When you double click on this, so this is a starting point. Whenever you want to work in SAP, you have to double click on, you have to first install this software and you need to double click on this so that you are able to see the different servers. Now you can see within SAP, in my case, I am having two servers. I am having ECC EHP 8 and I am having SAP S/4HANA 2020. Now it might happen that when you are working in a company, you might also be having different SAP systems. Maybe if you are working for different clients, or even if you are working for a single client, they can have a different system for development, quality, and production. If you remember last week, we discussed. So based on which system you want to connect, whether you want to connect to client A system or client B system, you'll be having a different list of SAP systems here. In our case, for the practice system, one system is enough. So you will be only provided with this S/4HANA 2020 system, so that you can start practicing on this system. Now, when you double click, it will ask you for user ID and password, right? Similar to any other software. When you log in into any other software, it will ask you the user ID and password. In addition to your user ID and password, it will also ask you the client and it will ask you the language in which you want to log into the system, right? So this user ID and password will be provided to you. Again, when you are working for a company, they will be giving you this user ID and password. In the test case, we will be providing you the user ID and password. So you'll be getting a mail either today or tomorrow. What you need to do is the same user ID and password, which is mentioned in the mail, you need to enter it here. Okay. Now, what do you mean by client? So whenever you are trying to log into SAP, it will ask you the client. By default, it will show you some client. If you want to change it, you can change it, provided that client is available. So for example, I'm just giving you the example of a client. So when you, let's assume in your company, if I double click on this, it allows you two different systems, one for, let's say, training purpose, and second for, let's say, the UAT purpose. So one is one system where you can perform the training, and second system where you can perform the UAT. So in that case, what I can do, or a basis can do, which means the technical consultants, what they will ask you to do is, when you want to perform the training, when you want to do the training, use client 100. And when you want to do the UAT, use client 200. In that case, they will be creating two separate clients for you, right? And that is the reason this client is important. This client is a completely kind of a different server. So for example, if my user ID is created for client 100 and not for client 200, in that case, if I change it to client 200 and try to log in, it may not work. Or maybe my password can be different for different clients. Okay, so just remember, client itself means a completely independent server. Okay, which means, maybe if I give the practical example, if you have two Facebook accounts, right, or two LinkedIn accounts. So when you try to go to the same website, linkedin.com or facebook.com, but within facebook.com, if you have two different accounts, based on if you have the access, you will be able to log in. If there is no access provided to you, in that case, you will not be able to log in, right? Or maybe just a similar example, let's say Facebook and LinkedIn are the two separate clients. If you have a user ID and password for Facebook, you will not be able to log into LinkedIn. Same way, the clients are completely independent of each other. Okay, so this client is important field. By default, in this server, it will come as 100. But when you are actually going to work for the client, when you are actually going to work in a company, you need to check with this with your technical team who will be providing you the user ID and password. They'll be also telling you which client to use. Okay. So based on what is your user ID and password, you will enter your user ID and password. Okay, and as soon as you press enter, it will take you to this screen. This is called as SAP Easy Access screen, or you can call it as SAP home page. This is a starting point. Whenever you log in into SAP, you will be able to see this SAP Easy Access. Now in this SAP Easy Access, you can go for any particular module. So you can see there are different modules here. This screen, what you are able to see, SAP Easy Access screen, this is a screen which is normally used by the end user. Okay, I hope it is very clear to you now what is end user. So those of you who are still not understood, let me take another 2-3 minutes to explain what are the different roles in the SAP project. So I think I gave you the example last time, company ABC Limited. Okay, let's assume there is a company ABC Limited who wants to implement SAP. Okay, ABC Limited is a manufacturing company and they want to implement SAP for them. Now, if they want to implement SAP, they have to buy the license from SAP. They have to pay something to SAP to get that software. So they paid to SAP, they got the software. Now, in order to use that software, they need a company who can help them implement it. So let's say ABC Limited approached Accenture company or Capgemini to implement SAP for them. Now, let's assume you are working under Accenture or Capgemini as a consultant. So what would be your responsibility as a consultant? You are going to implement SAP system for them. So you are a consultant. You are not the end user. Who is the end user? End user is from company ABC Limited. There will be different departments. There will be AP department, accounts payables, accounts receivables, general ledger accountant, someone who is taking care of banking. All these users who are working in that department, those are the end users, right? So when you log in into SAP by providing your user ID and password, the first screen that you will get is SAP Easy Access screen. And most of these transactions which are available here, these transactions are related to end user. As a consultant, normally I will not be using these transactions. Okay, so there is a segregation in SAP, the user screen and the consultant screen. So user, most of the time, they will be using SAP Easy Access to perform their transactions. Okay, as a consultant, what I'll be doing once I come to SAP Easy Access, instead of doing any transactions here, I will go to transaction SPRO. This is a screen which is called as a transaction code screen. From here, you can enter something and it will take you to another screen. So for example, if I write SPRO, this is called as transaction code, and press enter, you can see it is taking me to another screen. Here, if I click on SAP reference IMG, you can again see different modules like financial accounting, controlling. If you come down, you'll be able to see MM, materials management, SD, sales and distribution. So this is a screen which is, this is called as IMG, implementation guide. So this is a screen which you as a consultant will be using most of the time. As a consultants, we are there to implement SAP for them. As an end user, they will get this screen, SAP Easy Access, because they want to do day-to-day transactions. This is a screen which they will be using for performing day-to-day transactions. Okay, so I'll just take an example. If I am a end user and I want to create a supplier invoice, I received an invoice from the supplier, I want to post that invoice in the SAP system. So if I'm an end user and if I want to create an invoice, what I'll do, invoice is part of accounting, I'll go to accounting, financial accounting, and invoice from vendor, which means it is a accounts payable. Within accounts payable, document entry, this is where there is a screen. You can see this four digits, first four digits are nothing but transaction codes. Transaction code means instead of coming through this sequence, I can directly enter FB60 here. When I press enter, it will automatically take me to the invoice creation screen. So there are, in most of the transactions, SAP has provided the transaction codes. If you remember this transaction codes, it would be easier for you to process the transaction instead of again and again opening this folder. Within this folder, you need to open another. So instead of this navigation, if you remember the transaction code and press enter, it will directly take you to that particular screen. So you can see this is enter the vendor invoice screen. Now this is something which is a responsibility of an end user. End user will be posting the transaction. As a consultant, we are not there to post the transactions. As a consultant, what is our role? Our role is when this user is trying to post a transaction and if he is getting any error or he has any other requirement, in that case, they will come to us and they will ask us that this is what we want to create or this is what we want to improve in our this screen. For example, now currently what is happening? I need to enter the vendor here. Let me enter the vendor. Invoice date. Okay, I'll explain you what exactly is this. As of now, I'm just giving you the example. Now here, if I go to, let's say, payment. Or let's take this example itself. Now, what is happening? Whenever I'm trying to book an invoice, when I received the invoice from the vendor, system is giving me the error message. It is saying that entry in this field is mandatory. You can see an entry is required in field reference number. Now, if a business user comes to me and tells me why system is asking for this, I don't want this field as mandatory. I want to make this field as optional. So this control doesn't belong to end user. End user has no control to specify whether this is a mandatory field or optional field. This is where the consultant will come into the picture. So what they will do, if they are facing this kind of issues, they will be taking the screenshot, they will be sending it to either on mail or maybe there is a ticketing tool where support tickets are created. Okay, so they will create a ticket for you and you as a consultant, you will check with them. First, you will try to explain them why they are getting this error. They are getting this error because it is mandatory to enter the reference field. Okay, so first you will try to tell them that because it is mandatory field, that is the reason system is asking. If you want to get rid of this error, just maintain anything in the reference. Okay, now if a customer end user says, no, I know that. I know this is the error related to reference, But I don't want this to be a mandatory field. I want to keep it optional. Now, in that case, you have to do certain things from the consultant screen. And which is the consultant screen? SPRO. In SPRO, you can change the settings. You can make this field as optional field. So that is where the difference lies between the end user and a consultant. End user is going to perform the day-to-day transactions. End user is going to create a customer invoice from AR point of view. They are going to make the payment to the supplier from the AP point of view. They are going to book the normal adjustments at the month end from the GL point of view. They can purchase different assets from asset accounting point of view. So end user is responsible to process day-to-day transactions. And as a consultant, we are responsible that we want to ensure that the end user is able to perform their transactions without any problem. And whatever business requirements the end user has, we are there to make sure that they are able to utilize that in SAP. Okay, it should not happen that an end user is asking something. For example, this, if there is no enough knowledge as a consultant, then what will happen? Let's assume an end user comes to you and he says, "This I want to be optional field." But let's assume the consultant is very new or he is not aware about this functionality at all. And he is telling the customer, no, this is SAP standard. This is not possible in SAP. You have to maintain this. So that will create a wrong impression. If they came to know from other consultant that this can be easily changed to optional, right? Then it will create a trust issue. And that is the reason before you go to the customer, before you commit that whether this is possible or not, do your analysis. So thoroughly check. You can also check in Google. Good thing is for SAP, most of the things are very easily available on SAP. Whenever you are getting any error, whenever you have a particular requirement, if you just try it on Google, there is a very big SAP community in which definitely you will try to get the answer. Okay, so it is not like a particular requirement is only for a particular customer. Thousands of customers are using SAP. So if your customer is asking for a requirement, definitely many customers will be having the same requirement. And the answers are available on Google. So if you have this requirement, what to do, whether it is possible or not, those type of answers are available. So it is very much recommended that before you go to the customer and say, no, this is not possible, or you try to give the wrong solution to the customer, make sure that you have checked it thoroughly, whether this functionality is available or not, and then only you go to the customer and commit it. This is how it can be solved. Okay, clear till now? Any questions? You understood who is end user, who is consultant, how to log into SAP, what is client, what is user ID, what is password, and then in order to access the end user screens, what I need to use, and in order to access the consultant screen, just remember we need a transaction code SPRO. As a consultant, I think more than 60 to 70% of the time in the project, you are going to work on SPRO. Okay, any questions till now?
Sir, I did not get the client part. I mean, what is it?
So client, yeah, client,
I
as
mean,
I told
a
you.
Consultants, different clients or the different sections.
Companies.
In the company itself.
Company itself, it is not for consultant. Okay. Whenever we are logging to client, whenever you are logging to SAP system, the client is not meant for the consultant or the end user. It is meant for each and everyone, right? So in order to keep separate, for example, see, let's take example. Let's assume I have this one client only. Okay. I am using the same client to give the training to the end users. Okay. And I am also using the same client for end users to perform the UAT. Okay. So what will be the problem? The users who are performing the UAT, okay, they might get disturbed because of the data which is being created by the training team. Let's assume I have created an invoice in the training system. In the training, when I was giving the training, I have created a vendor invoice. Okay. Or let's say a UAT person has created a train invoice. Let's say a user is doing the UAT. UAT means user acceptance test, which means end user is trying to test whether system is working fine or not. So he has created an invoice, okay, and he wanted to make the payment. So today he has created an invoice and he has planned for tomorrow. Tomorrow I'll be doing payment in UAT system. But someone from the training batch, he was not aware that what is happening in UAT. He came and he has made the payment of that invoice. So what will happen? There will be a problem because UAT don't want to allow anyone else to use their data. Same way, we don't want one person to make the change in another person's system and create a problem. And that is the reason what we can do is we can ask our technical team that because these two things are completely independent, can you give us two different clients so that training people will work on their client and UAT people will work on their client. Okay, other example which I can give. Now there are in this batch or including all the batches that I'm taking, let's say overall there are 50 students. All of you are going to use the same system, right? So it may happen that you have created something. Any other user, he came from maybe other batch. So from CEO batch, someone came and he has changed the data in your company code. In that case, what would be your reaction? You will say, sir, I created something, but somebody has deleted my data. What should I do now? So in that case, what we normally do is we create two separate clients. One for FI training, second for CEO training, so that the users are unnecessarily not touching each other's system. So that is the purpose of client. Normally client is created to segregate the data for different purpose. Is it clear now? Is it clear? Okay. Yeah, any other questions? Hello. Yes, Anjali, go ahead.
Yeah, sir, I just want to know that you told us that there would be some cost if I want to make some changes in invoice, and it would be easier to remember any code. So I just want to ask, this code will this code be similar for each and every company according to universal code, or would it be different for each and every company and we'll have to remember according to company whenever we go to join?
No, this codes will remain same. See, again, there are two type of codes. One is standard code and one is custom code. So let me tell you what exactly I mean. See, when you talk about the transaction codes, there are two type of transaction codes, standard and custom. Standard means what is already provided by SAP. Okay, so SAP already has provided the transaction code for vendor invoice, it is FB60. SAP has already provided the transaction code for customer invoice, which is FB70. So standard which are provided by SAP will remain same for all the customers. Whenever you are going to work on any customer in SAP, maybe the project is in Europe or it is in US or it is in Middle East, they will be using the same transactions. Custom means developed by customer. So let's assume SAP has provided the standard codes, but when you are working for a customer, customer is not happy with the standard code. They want to create their own. They want to change something in the standard and they want to create their own. So normally this starts with Z. Z. Okay, so for India, you will say why I'm saying Z. It is Z. Just remember, in when you are working as a SAP consultant, you will not never call this as Z. It is called as Z because SAP is a European product. And in Europe, they call it as Z, right? So Z means starting with Z. So for example, I am not happy with the standard code which is provided by SAP, which is FB60. So what I'll do is I will change it to ZFB60, which means it is my own flavor of customer's own flavor of the standard transaction code. So they might have added some fields, they might have removed some fields, and they created their own transaction code. So if this code developed by a customer is customer specific, so which means if you go to another project, you may find that this code doesn't exist, or maybe this code exists, but this is looking completely different than the other customer because it is developed by customer itself. It is not something which is available as standard. Clear, Anjali?
Okay. I just wanted to know, like, the end user. End user is nothing but the one who will be testing if something is somewhere, something is stuck like that, right?
Not only testing, during the project, he will be testing, but actually he is going to use that system once it is live. So accountant, for example, accountant is my end user. For FI, when we are learning FI, our accountants are our end users. Okay, accountant may be in AP department, maybe in AR department, maybe in assets, maybe in GL, but those are our end users who are going to actually post these invoices, make the payment. So why they are testing? They are testing because they can provide us the feedback whether it is matching their business requirements or not. But actually they are going to use it once the system goes live.
Okay. So even we can be that account users, right?
See, we are learning currently the course which will help you to become a consultant. Okay, as a consultant, you will be always learning what an end user does. So definitely all those transactions which end user is going to perform, you are also going to learn in this course. But in addition, your learning is not restricted to the end user. Your learning would be, you will be able to do the consulting role also, right? So you are not the accountant. You are going to be the consultant after this course. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes.
Actually, FB60 is a accounts payable purpose, so that is a code, correct?
Yes.
But in our company present, I'm working in that company, F53 is a manual payment, accounts payable purpose, and F11 is a automatic payments. I mean, accounts payable purpose. That is a custom standard.
Standards. You are using what? F-53, right?
Yes.
Yeah, you can see
F-53 is the manual payment.
So normally, as I told you, normally custom processes, custom transaction codes start with Z.
It starts with Z. Okay.
If it is F, it is normally standard. So if I show you here itself for payment, you can see for payment, let me go to, it should be here itself. Yes. So outgoing payment, you can see F-53. This is standard. That is the reason it is available in this system also. So in your company also, you are using the same, right? For automatic payment, as you said, it is coming under the periodic processing.
Yeah.
Here also, you can see F110, which is again a standard transaction.
Okay.
So if it is a custom transaction, it will normally start with Z.
Okay.
Transactions which are starting from F, those are the standard FI transactions.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Vikram, to interrupt. Does SAP provide any provision for retention? Concept of retention on an invoice, like, you know, certain part of
our. Yeah, for UZ vendors. You can use a UZ vendor, sir.
Yeah. So let's not talk about that, because let's not talk about a particular process. As of now, we don't know what is accounts payable. Retention would be too advanced topic at this stage. Let's focus on what we are discussing at this stage.
Okay.
Is it clear now whether what is standard, what is custom?
Yes.
Okay. Now let's go ahead and try to understand if I want to implement. Okay. Now think in this way. a new customer, again, I'm again and again going to take this example, ABC Limited has decided they want to go for SAP S/4HANA. They have bought the licenses from SAP. They have given the consulting job to, let's say, Accenture. And let's assume each one of you is a consultant who is working with Accenture. And now Accenture has asked you, as a FI consultant, you are responsible for this implementation project. Okay. And let's assume you are on day one of your project. Okay. Or let's say day one is just for kickoff and other socialization. But let's say you are in the first month or the first week of the project. So what exactly are you going to do? Have we discussed on SAP Activate and SAP ASAP in our last session? We had the discussion on SAP ASAP.
Yeah, we discussed.
Yes,
we discussed, yes. Right? Yeah. So can you tell me any project, whenever we are starting a project, what is the first phase in the SAP S/4HANA projects?
Project preparation.
Okay, so if I'm following SAP ASAP methodology, it is project preparation phase. And if I'm following SAP Activate methodology, it is prepare phase. But again, the tasks within the projects are same. So as a SAP, when you start a SAP project, let's say we are currently in the project preparation phase. What will happen in project preparation phase? In project preparation phase, your project manager, okay, who will be assigned, let's say Accenture has assigned a particular project manager who will be completely monitoring and planning this particular project. Now, project manager will decide which consultants are going to work on this project. Okay, and let's assume in the project preparation phase, this project manager may need to take your interviews before he decide that whether you are fit for this project or not. So let's assume Accenture has hired you. Okay, you are for 1 or 2 months, you are just enjoying, you are just completing the joining formalities, nothing to do, no project assigned. Very common this. This is very common when you join any SAP company. Okay, so they will not directly hire you and put you to the project. You will be there for few days in a bench, right? So you will be waiting for your first project to be assigned. Let's say you joined a project 1 or 2 months back, sorry, the company 1 or 2 months back, and now different project managers are interested to take you because you are on the bench and they want to utilize you. So they may take the interviews if required. Otherwise, they can just take you as a junior consultant because they already have some senior consultants who are going to work on the project. They just need you to help them on day-to-day basis. Right, so you will be initial 1 or 2 projects, you will be like a junior consultant where you may not be directly interacting with the customer. There will be senior consultants who are interacting with the customer, but you will be helping the senior consultants in whatever way you want. Okay, so if you are comfortable, senior consultant give you most of the responsibilities related to the configuration in the system, right? If you are learning, not very much comfortable, then he will ask you, okay, what things you can do and what things others can do. So based on that, they will decide like what would be your role in that particular project. Now let's assume a project manager has taken your interview. You have told them very clear that I know SAP S/4HANA, but I have not got a chance to work on the project, but once I get a chance, definitely I'll be able to perform. So project manager has decided, yes, you are going to be the resource who is going to work on the project. Okay, so you got your first project, but still that project is in the preparation phase. So your project manager has just decided that you are going to work in this project, but for next 15, 20, 30 days, after that, no communication from the project manager, or maybe you got a project communication from project manager that this project is assigned to you, and we will inform you once this project gets started, right? So till the time project preparation phase goes, there is normally no requirement of the functional consultants. So during the project preparation phase, like he has identified you, project manager will keep on identifying different resources. They will ensure that the laptops or computers or other hardware requirements are available so that we can start working on the project. Now, when the project will start from a consultant's point of view, once the project preparation phase is over, what is the next phase? After project preparation, what?
Yes, blueprint.
Blueprint.
If you are following SAP methodology, the next phase would be business blueprint. And if you are following Activate, in that case, what is the next phase?
Explore.
The purpose of business blueprint and explore is exactly same. Okay, the purpose, the end objective, why we need to perform the business blueprint and why we need to perform the explore is to ensure that we know what a customer wants in SAP and how are we going to implement that for customer. So the objective of the business blueprinting phase is identify what customers wants to implement. In SAP, there are thousands of functionalities. Okay, it may happen that customer is only looking for 500 functionalities. He's not looking for the remaining 500 functionalities. To be frank, if I talk about the overall SAP point of view, not only finance, overall SAP point of view, in SAP, if there are 1,000 functionalities, none of the customer uses more than 200. Okay, there is a reason. Each industry is different. For example, a manufacturing company will use PP module, while other company who is into the distribution, they don't need PP module at all. Right? So I'm talking about the overall picture, not only FI. So overall, if there are 1,000 functionalities available in SAP, none of the customers you will find they are using more than 200 functionalities. Now, if I talk from the finance point of view, let's assume in finance, there are overall 100 functionalities. Okay, I'm only talking about finance, no controlling, no FSCM, no other financial components, only basic finance, core finance, which includes FI, GL, AP, AR, asset accounting and bank accounting. So within these five components, within these five subcomponents, let's assume there are total 100 features available from SAP. It is not necessary that this each and every customer will use all the 100 features. So you need to understand what features needs to be implemented for this customer. And it may happen that customer has decided that out of 100, they want to implement 70 features. Now, the second question would be, this 70 features are already pre-delivered by SAP, but it may happen that out of those 70, customer is happy with the 60 features what are pre-delivered by SAP. So customer is ready to use as it is without making any modifications. Whatever is available from SAP, customer is okay to go ahead with those 60 processes. But for remaining 10, although SAP has provided those features, but customer want some changes. Customer is not happy with the way SAP has provided. They want to make some changes. So there exactly the Z will come. Z means when customer is not happy with the standard, they want to make some changes to the standard processes. That 10%, 10 features which we identified, those are called as the gap. So 60 is fit. Fit means you want SAP as provided as it is. So these features are fitting in your business requirement. There are 10 features which SAP has provided, but you are not happy with the way SAP has provided. So those are maybe gap, right? So that is called as customization. Yes, Nidhi is saying it is called as customization. So customization means something which is not available from SAP as it is. We need to change it according to the business requirement of the customer. So at the end of the business blueprinting phase, at the end of the explore phase, we want a list of those features which customer wants to implement as it is. And we want to have a list of those features which customer wants to use it, but not as it is. They want to make some changes with the detailed explanation, what changes are required and how you have planned to make those changes. So this is what we want at the end of the business blueprint or the explore phase. And let's assume this entire project duration is 1 year. Okay, so initial first month was in project preparation. Now we are left with 11 months. And now you are working on the project, business blueprinting or explore phase has been started and you have been given 3 months. Okay, let's say from June onwards, the project is started. So June, July, August. August 31st is a date. It is a planned or expected date to complete the business blueprint and explore phase and come up with a complete documentation. Now in this 3 months, you need to finalize what are the business requirements which are fit, what are the business requirements which are gaps. Now you tell me from today itself, if you have 3 months to gather this requirement, what you will do. So what are you supposed to do in the business blueprint phase and what you are supposed to do in the explore phase?
I need to start meeting the end users or key users and gather the requirement.
Exactly. We need to, in this 3 months, we need to understand what customer wants. And how will I know what customer wants? I have to sit with them. I have to understand their requirements, right? I have to ask them what you are doing today. Where are the problems? Why are you not happy with your current system? Which features you want to improvise? Okay. If I am following the business blueprinting, it would be theoretical discussion. I'll be just discussing theoretically that, okay, what you want. He will say, okay, I want to create an invoice and then I want to make the payment or then I want to make the automatic payment. So this will be the theoretical discussion and you will be writing on the piece of paper. This piece of paper that you are going to create is called as a business blueprint document. So if it is a theoretical discussion, you will keep on noting what customer is doing today and what they want to use in future, how they will be using that in SAP. So that document, which will clearly tell what is the customer process today and what they want to use in SAP, that is called as a business blueprint document. In order to create this document, on day-to-day basis, you need to spend around 4 to 5 hours with the end user or a key user. What is the difference between the end user and a key user? So let's assume in a company, there are 10 accountants. Okay, and all these are end users for you because ultimately these are the 10 accountants who are going to do the transactions on day-to-day basis. But some of the users out of this 10 would be very junior. They are just like, they just completed their MCOM, BCOM, and they just started working on the system in the company. Okay, and maybe they just joined 1 or 2 months back. So definitely those persons are not for use to you, right? They cannot be useful to you because they themselves joined this company today itself and they don't know what are the business processes, what are the requirements. They are also trying to understand how this company works. So out of this 10, there will be 1 or 2 guys who are in this company maybe from 8, 10, 20 years, who know the process end to end, who knows what exactly we want in the system. So although those are also end users, this 1 or 2 person who are end users, but they are very key to you. They are very important to you because they know in and out. If you convince them, then they will automatically convince the remaining 10 end users. So within the end users also, there is a key user. So your focus would be to speak to key user on day-to-day basis, understand his requirement, document it. So you will take a topic for one day. I will discuss this today with the end user. You will close that topic. Next day, you will take another topic. So like this, for the next 3 months, you will try to complete each and every area which comes under finance. Okay, so it might also happen that when you are working on the project, you are not given the entire FI area. You are only responsible to gather the requirement on AP, or you are only required to gather the requirement on AR. So let's say there are 5 consultants working on this project. One is responsible for AR, second is responsible for AP, third is responsible for basic FI, fourth is responsible for banking. So based on what is your role, you have to do the discussions with the end users or the key users. So if you are from AP, definitely you will not get the information from AR. You will be focusing only on the AP department. You will understand what is how the AP department works today and how they want to use it in future in SAP. Right? So you are right. The first thing that you will start is understanding the business requirements of the customer. Now, think about what is the first thing that you need to understand from the business. What is the first thing? You will start with AP, or you will start with AR, or you will start with GL, or you will start with asset accounting, or you will start with banking. What would be the first thing that, okay, let's say day one, just now the project is started. On day one, my manager has given me 4 hours. He has given me a slot that this 4 hours you need to sit with the business. You tell me what are you going to understand from the business? What in this 4 hours, what would be your objective?
Their understanding their process, that what do they do?
So everything is process. AP is also process. AR is also process. GL is also process. Asset accounting is also process. Which process you will understand?
What are the steps in that process?
Starts with GL. Starts with general ledger.
Okay, starts with GL. Fine. In GL, what you need to gather first thing?
How many companies are maintaining? Like, you know, it's a single company or multinational company. They have a number of plants in the same company. For example, we'll take a Reliance. Reliance is a single company under which there are so many, n number of companies again, like, you know, Reliance Petroleum, Reliance Telecom, Reliance so and so.
Right. So, very correct answer. The first thing that you want to know before you go in any process, before you go to GL, before you go to AP, AR, that will follow. At least first 1 or 2 weeks, not only first day, at least first 1 or 2 weeks, you are only going to concentrate on enterprise structure. Okay, what do you mean by enterprise structure? Just now what we heard, enterprise structure consists of how many legal entities. So the questions that you are going to ask in the first week of your project is, first question is, how many legal entities do a customer has? Okay, obviously it may happen. Okay, I'm writing another question. Out of these legal entities, how many we want to implement in SAP in current phase? I'll tell you what exactly is current phase. Okay, how many plants they have? What is their financial year? So whether the financial year is April to March, or it is Jan to December, or it is July to June. Okay, what is their financial year? Right? And what are their reporting requirements for financial statements? Okay, this is not a complete list. So you will get a list of this when you start working on the project. Maybe your project manager will give you the list, or your senior consultant will give you the list. So this list may change based on the industry and all, but these are some of the common things that you should start your discussion with. Okay, let me explain this one by one. So let's take a simple example. Okay, now what I need to do is, I need to take a dummy project so that you understand it very well. And let's assume I'm taking the same company. ABC Limited is a computer manufacturing company. Okay, you can take any example. So when you are going to practice in this system, you also need to think about a particular company, what would be the nature of the business, and what exactly they will be doing. So now I am trying to provide you the scenario. So ABC Limited is a computer manufacturing company. They manufacture let's say computers, laptops, tabs, etc. Okay, there are two legal entities for this company. Number one is, let's say, ABC India Limited. Okay, this is a company which manufactures, and then there is another company, ABC US Limited. Okay, or ABC UN, there normally they use INC, whatever way you want. So there are two legal entities. What do you mean by legal entity? This is very important. If you want to understand finance, the first thing that you should remember is legal entity. What do you mean by legal entity?
Registered entity.
Reporting.
Registered.
Reporting. Financial reporting.
Separate books of accounts.
Separate book of accounts. This is one important point. Second one I heard is registered company. These two things are important. So legal entities are the registered entities. Okay, so for example, if you want to start a company, let's say you want to start your own company. So either you will start a private limited company or a public company. So this private limited or a limited company, this is an entity. So for this company, ABC Limited, they have a registered entity, ABC India Limited, for which they want to generate their separate financial books. Okay, now definitely at the group level, if I want to know what is the total profit or total balance sheet for ABC Limited, I will combine both. But from the legal point of view, in India, when I'm paying the GST and other taxes, they are going to ask me, what is your business for ABC India Limited? Similarly, in US, I need to provide the reporting in ABC US. So these are the legal entities. Very important. The first thing that you need to understand on day one itself when you are working on the project is you need to understand how many legal entities do they have. Okay, so ABC Limited is a computer manufacturing company. They manufacture computers, laptops, tabs, etc. There are two legal entities. Now, obviously, can you tell me ABC India Limited will follow which financial year? In India, what is the financial year?
July to June.
April to March.
April.
April to March.
Yes. So in India, it is April to March. What about in US?
Jan to December.
So similarly, if there are more entities, okay, so for example, when you are working on the actual project, there can be more than 100, 200 entities, legal entities. Okay, I'm talking about the complex projects where the duration is 3 years, 4 years. In that project, you may get 100 entities, 200 entities. But if you are working on the mid-size project, normally 2, 4, 5 different entities they have. Right, so in this example, we are taking there are two legal entities, ABC India Limited, which will follow April to March. And then there is ABC US, which will follow Jan to December. Okay. In addition, ABC India has three plants, manufacturing plants, where the manufacturing takes place. It is in Bangalore, Mumbai, and let's say Kolkata. So these are the three places where ABC India has a plant. ABC US has only one selling plant. Okay, I'm not talking about selling or manufacturing. I'm just entering plant. I'll tell you what is the difference. Only one plant in New York. Okay, so ABC India Limited has three plants in Bangalore, Mumbai. US has one plant. So let's assume these three plants are manufacturing plants where the manufacturing takes place. And this one, New York, it is not for manufacturing. It is for the sales directly. So whatever is manufactured in Bangalore, Mumbai and Kolkata, let's say it gets exported. It is received by US entity and from US it is being sold to the US market. Okay. And also in India, let's say 60% of the manufacturing which takes place, that is directly sold in India, and 40% is transferred to US to make the sale in US. Okay, so that is exactly what you need to understand. The first 1 week, you need to understand ins and outs of what exactly this customer is doing today. Then only you will be able to provide them the solution. If you don't know what is their business, what they are doing, right? If you just think from the SAP point of view, that what I need to do in SAP, how to configure SAP, that is never going to make you a consultant. You will become a consultant when you have the business mindset, not the technical mindset. Okay, it will take time. I'm not saying immediately on the first project you will work as a consultant. It will take time, but more you will understand the business, more you would be able to provide the solution to the customer. It may happen that after 5-6 years, you never need to go to the SPRO screen because you are an expert. You are just telling the customer how your business requirements will get mapped. And then you have the juniors who will be doing the SPRO activity. But if you just focus on SPRO without understanding the business, then for maybe 15, 20 years, you will just become a SPRO consultant. It will be like, you tell me what I should do in SPRO and I'll set up for you, but I don't know what customer is looking for. Right? So this is what is a requirement. There are three plants. There is one plant in New York and there are three plants in India. Now let's make some more complications. So we said they manufacture computers, laptops and tabs. Okay, ABC Limited has, let's say, 8 departments in their organization. Okay, which 8 departments? So it is just like this, ABC Limited. Within ABC Limited, we have ABC India. Within ABC India, sorry, ABC India and ABC US. In ABC India, we have finance department, we have production department, we have HR department, we have IT department. So finance, production, HR, IT, can you tell me what are the other departments that we have in the organization?
Sales and marketing.
Sales department, yes. What else?
Marketing.
Admin. Okay.
Logistics, what we can say.
Logistics is production, production and sales. Okay. Yeah, you can say store. Yes, you can say stores department. Okay. What else?
Drawing design.
Okay, this much is design.
Procurement.
Procurement.
R&D.
I think we can include procurement and stores here. Okay, if you want, again, it depends upon the actual requirement of the company. So if they have a separate stores department and separate procurement department, then definitely you need to create a procurement department here. So that is fine. So
quality department.
Quality department. So you can keep on naming whatever departments they have, right? You're right. It can be a quality department. There can be n number of departments. I'm just taking example. If you really go and see the company, they may be having 20, 25 departments. That is completely fine. So you need to understand how many departments they have. Same way in ABC US also, I may not have all the departments because I'm not doing any manufacturing there. So finance is fine. I don't need production. Okay. I may not need stores. Stores is required because I'm storing the material there. Procurement is fine. Quality may not be required. So let's assume this is my hierarchy. This is the list of departments that I have. So I'll say below department instead of numbering it. ABC Limited has below departments in the organization. Okay. What else? Now ABC Limited want their financial reports. What are the financial reports? Balance sheet, profit and loss,
cash flow,
right? So these are all the financial statements, cash flow report, etc. At below level, this is important, at below level. So can you tell me what are the levels at which we need to generate the financial statements? Number one, definitely a legal entity, or before that, number one would be at group level, which means overall group level reporting. What is my total profit and loss? What is my total balance sheet for ABC Limited without restricting to India and US, consolidated India plus US? What is the total profitability? What is the total balance sheet? I want to consolidate both. So this group means, which includes ABC India plus ABC US, right? So this is the first level report. What is the second level report? Legal entity level, right? What do you mean by legal entity level? So separately for ABC India and separately for ABC US. This is my second level requirement. In addition, I want product level. What are my products? What I'm manufacturing? I'm manufacturing computers. I'm manufacturing laptops. I'm manufacturing tabs. So may not be balance sheet. Okay, I may not look for the balance sheet at this level, but profit and loss. I want to make sure that how much profitability I'm making at computers, how much profitability I'm making for laptops, how much profitability I'm making for tabs. So the third level report, which I want, is at the product level. So computer, laptop, and tabs. Okay, so this is, I'm clearly mentioning, this is a, I want a profit and loss. I don't want balance sheet at this level. So profit and loss is required at this level. And then again, profit and loss is required at plant level. How many plants I have?
Four.
Okay, I have total four plants, which is Bengaluru. I have Mumbai and Kolkata, right? These are the three plants in India, and then I have a New York plant in US. Okay, so this is my fourth level requirement. These are the requirements that I have. Profit and loss. For cost, expenses, I want the list of expenses according to departments. I want to know who is making expenses, whether it is a HR department, or it is an admin department, or it is an IT department, or sales, whatever we have created. I want the expense level report at the department level. Right? So this is a high level requirement. Okay, when you deep down, you have 3 months. This is what you are getting in first or second day. Definitely, in addition to this, there will be a lot of other requirements which you will collect from the customer, and then you will try to provide the solution in SAP. Okay, so as of now, let's assume this is my business requirement. On day one, I understood this much business requirement. How I am going to map this in SAP? Okay, so this is called as is, or this is called as a business requirement. As is means, what is customer doing today? How customer is doing out of SAP today? Forget about SAP. So customer is having two departments. Sorry, customer is having two legal entities. Customer is having this many number of plants. Customer is following this financial year. This is what is as is. This is what is the requirement from the customer. Now in SAP, how are you going to fit this requirements? That is called as 2B. 2B means what will be implemented in SAP. How it will be implemented in SAP, right? So if I talk from first point itself, ABC Limited is a computer manufacturing company. So ABC Limited will become what? What is my ABC Limited? Is it a legal entity? Is it a group, or what exactly?
It's a group.
Group.
It is a group.
It's a group.
Okay. So what I'm going to create this group as in my SAP system.
Company?
In SAP, no. In SAP S/4HANA, we don't need to create anything because group level reporting, or maybe because now we are talking about group reporting, so I'll not say like this. This statement would be wrong in that case, because now we have a group reporting concept in SAP. This will be taken care by group reporting module in SAP. Previously, this group reporting module was called as SAP BPC, Business Planning and Consolidation. Okay, so as a finance consultant, we don't need to worry about this group. This requirement to generate the report at the group level, this will be taken care by a new module, which is introduced in SAP S/4HANA, I think only 2 years back, which is group reporting. Okay, so as a finance consultant, SAP Finance, if I segregate it with all other modules, SAP Finance is responsible for providing you the reports at the legal entity level. At the group level reporting, if you want the group level reporting, then you have to use advanced modules like BPC, which is now called as group reporting in S/4HANA. Okay, so this one, you forget it. You don't need to create this anywhere in the SAP system. They manufacture computers, or maybe this is fine. We'll come to this. There are two legal entities. What are we going to create these two legal entities as in SAP? So legal entities are company codes in SAP. In SAP, we are going to create these two legal entities as company codes. Whenever you hear a terminology legal entity equal to company code in SAP, which means we need to create two company codes in SAP, ABC India Limited and ABC US. Okay, so this will be created as company codes in SAP. This April to March, Jan to December, these are called as fiscal year variants. Okay, we'll talk about that in detail. So this April to March is a fiscal year variant. Jan to December is a fiscal year variant, which we need to assign to the company code. So when we create a company code, we need to tell the system that this company code will follow April to March fiscal year variant. This company will follow Jan to December fiscal year variant. So we'll talk about that. ABC India has 3 plants, Bangalore, Mumbai, Kolkata. What are we going to do in SAP to specify that these are 3 plants? So in SAP, location, okay. What else?
Business areas,
yes. Okay, so let me explain. See, in SAP, in addition to FI module, you are responsible for FI, right? But it is not that this customer is only implementing FI module. This customer is a manufacturing company. They want to implement MM, they want to implement SD, they want to implement PP, maybe HR. So they want to implement n number of modules in SAP. You are responsible from finance side, but there are other consultants who are responsible for MMSD, PP side. So in logistics means MMSD, PP. These are the logistics modules. In logistics, we will be creating this as plants. So in SAP, we have a concept of plants. We can create the plants, but from finance point of view, also for reporting, because plants is available in logistics module. If I want to generate a report in FI for plant level, I cannot. So I need to create in finance, I need to create business areas. Business areas are my reporting parameters from finance point of view. So what I'll do, each and every
plant I will create as business area, and I will assign the plants to business areas, which means whenever a logistics is doing any transaction, when they are purchasing anything in Bangalore location, in the accounting entry, automatically Bangalore location will determine business area as Bangalore. So I'll be able to generate my logistics reports from plants, and I'll be able to generate my financial reports using business areas. Okay, so business areas will be used for the plant level requirements. A very good question. You will find this confusion throughout the industry. There was one question on the chat screen. Are business areas still supported in S/4HANA? Because few year back, around 10, 12 years back, there was an announcement which was made by SAP that business area may not be supported in future. Okay, but then I think even more than 10, 15 years, maybe more than 20 years back. But then SAP came up with the concept of new GL accounting. Once new GL accounting came into picture, whatever were the challenges in business areas, previously business area having some challenges. And that is the reason SAP was, or the customers were not happy with the business area functionality. So SAP made the statement, they said business area, you can use it temporarily, but going forward, we will come up with better approach and business area may not be required in future. But then when SAP came up with new GL accounting, okay, business area was also improvised, and with new GL functionalities, business area can give you the desired result without any problems. And that is the reason even today also in SAP S/4HANA, business area is supported, and there is no communication from SAP that business area is going to expire in few years. So there is nothing even in the projects that we are working currently. We have verified with SAP whether we can use the business area or not. They confirmed that as of now, there is no plan to deactivate it. So you can continue to use it. And we have implemented the business areas in many companies even today also. Right. So till the time SAP is not saying don't use business areas, we are open to use business areas. And whenever SAP will come and say maybe business area is not supported, it will be only for the new implementations at that time. It will not impact the customers who are already using business areas, right? And when SAP will expire the business areas, they will come up with the another approach that instead of business areas, what you can use. Okay, so as of today, there is no restriction. We can continue to use the business areas.
So Vikram.
Yes.
I had a question. So what I understand is, as a finance consultant, we will create the business areas like Bangalore, Mumbai, Kolkata, and logistics will create plants which will be assigned to those business areas, right?
Exactly. Exactly. Yes. Your understanding is correct.
Perfect. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So this will be our business areas. We are going to create this even New York as a business area. Now ABC Limited has below departments. Whenever you hear this term departments, what is the nature of department? Why there are departments in the organization? Why do we have different departments, HR department, admin department?
To segregate the functionalities or duties.
To segregate the duties. But what normally departments do? Do they earn you profit? Do they sell anything in the market?
Actually, the company wants to know which department is incurring the profit, which department is incurring the more expenses. And it is like a CEO, management level.
Okay. Let's concentrate on the terms that you mentioned. You said if a company wants to know which department is giving profit, is it a correct terminology? HR department will give me some profit. Admin department will give me some profit.
These are kind of shared services, no?
These are shared services, but they are not going to give you any profit. You cannot generate a report that HR department has given me how much profit and admin department has given me how much profit. They are there to support your business. Okay, so profit cannot be determined. Yeah, so departments cannot tell you how much profitability they have given you. Okay, departments are only going to incur the cost. Definitely, we are not saying that they are not contributing to the business. They are only incurring the cost. They are contributing the business overall, but we cannot determine the profit at the department level. So departments itself means the areas within a company who are responsible to incur a cost. And that is the reason they are called as cost centers in SAP. Departments equal to cost centers. So if I want to know, whenever I'm making expense, let's say I like one of the employee, or let's say HR is arranging a walk-in round. HR is arranging the walk-in interviews. In those walk-in interviews, definitely there will be some cost involved. Okay, you will be arranging maybe a cafeteria, maybe some snacks for the participants who are appearing in the interviews. Maybe if you don't have your own facility, you will be taking something on rent where the interviews will be conducted. Let's think from the small company point of view. Okay, there are many companies who are arranging the interviews in some third party locations, which is not their own location. So they are bearing the expenses, rent. Okay, marketing department, again, take an example, sales and marketing department, they are doing various promotions. Okay, so let's say they are doing the promotion to in Facebook. So they are incurring some expenses in order to create a like to create a brand. Okay, so for example, they are doing some advertisements in LinkedIn, in Facebook. So that is again a cost. So if I want to know that total cost, HR has arranged the walk-in interview. So if I want to book that refreshment cost, I want to know who is responsible for this cost. It is HR department. There was a marketing event which was done. Whose department for that? Who is responsible for that cost? My marketing department. So each and every expense, whenever you are going to make any expense, system will ask you against which department you are making this expense. So you have to enter one of this expense, one of this cost center in the posting. Okay, and tomorrow if you come up with a new department, definitely you need to create a new cost center so that you can book the cost in that department. Clear? So this is nothing but cost centers. If I come down, now ABC Limited want their financial reports, balance sheet, profit and loss, cash flow at below level. So first of all, at the group level, I clearly told you, the group level reporting is taken care in BPC module or group reporting module in SAP. It will not be done within your SAP FI module. Legal entity level reporting, yes, very much possible. We will be creating a legal entity level reports. In addition to that, if I want my profit and loss reports at the product level, so computers, laptops, tabs, what are this? How can I? What should I create them in SAP in order to generate the reports? So normally this product level reports are called as profit centers. Because for a product, you are incurring some cost, and for the product, you are getting some sales value. So sales price minus cost price will become your profit. And that is the reason these products are your profit centers. So if I want to know what is my profitability for computers, I can go to my profit center reporting. I will enter that I want to see the report for computers as a profit center. It will give me the profit and loss report for that particular product. So that is profit centers. Okay, plants we already discussed. Plants are our business areas in FI, and those are our plants in logistics module. And expenses at the department level, we also understood. These are what? These are our cost centers. So these are the important terminologies which are part of the enterprise structure in SAP. So what we need to do is, the first thing that we need to do is identify the enterprise structure of the company. Based on the enterprise structure, we need to come up with the enterprise structure in SAP. We need to create all these things in SAP so that the user is able to perform the transactions. Okay, so normally what happens is, let's do this thing. Maybe I have not done this thing till now, till today. What I normally follow is I normally complete one explanation and then I directly jump to SAP. So for example, we finalize, we will be creating one company. We'll be creating this money fiscal year variance. We'll be doing this logistics. We'll be creating cost centers. And immediately I jump into the SAP screen to show you how exactly it will work. In this particular batch, what I'm planning is let's get an actual feel of the project. So we will first complete the explore phase. Okay, we understood what is the enterprise structure requirement. Okay, what I'll do is in tomorrow's session, we will try to create a business blueprint from scratch, or we will try to create a Excel file, which is a output of the explore phase, which will clearly tell you what is the business requirement of the customer. Okay, so for next few weeks, maybe 1 or 2 weeks, we will understand the requirement from GL side. We will understand the requirement from AP side, AR side, asset side, bank side. And once we are clear with what needs to be implemented in SAP, which is kind of a real-time project, then we will go to the SAP screen and we will configure those scenarios. Right? I think this is something which came to my mind just now, but I think you are definitely going to enjoy this way rather than the older way of doing the trainings. Because if I do that, you will be able to understand, but you will not get the real feel of how the actual projects are implemented in SAP. So let's do this in this way. I think that will be beneficial for you.
So Vikram, a quick question regarding the enterprise structure. Yeah. I know we discussed when it comes to the real time. So again, it is like a high level decision from the business point of view, right? So how they have to treat each and every entity.
Yes, definitely. So see, you are just there to suggest them. Ultimately, what is required to be created, whether this is correct or not, whether you have to explain this once you finalize 2B. Once you finalize that, okay, this 2 I'm going to create as company code, this 2 I'm 3 I'm going to create as business area, this would require a review with the customer also, so that he is able to understand this SAP terminologies and he has agreed that yes, you understood my requirements correctly and you can go ahead now and configure in the system.
Yeah, so these are the main structure, right? Once it is finalized, it cannot be changed.
See, it cannot be changed means definitely if you are coming up with a new company, if you are starting a new legal entity in Australia, for example, then definitely you can create another legal entity here. That is called as a company rollout. So there are three kind of projects, right? Implementation, which you are doing for the first time. Support, which means customer has started using SAP and he is getting some day-to-day issues. So those will be support. And third kind of project that you have in SAP is a rollout project. Rollout means once you are implemented, now if you want to bring a new company code, if you want to bring a new company code, that is called as a company rollout. If you want to bring a new plant, let's say you started a new manufacturing location. So new plant is called as a plant rollout. So rollouts can be done. That can be changed.
No, I meant to say like once they started to use business areas and they cannot change that business areas to another form, right?
No, that is something which is difficult. That is something which will change the entire structure of your company. So you need to be very clear. You need to be very clear with the enterprise structure. You can always add new company codes, new plants. But if you are saying today I'm using plants as business area, tomorrow if I want to use my plants as profit centers, is it possible? That is something which will require a lot of effort and not recommended at all.
Yeah.
So you need to be very clear when you are deciding this, because see this, I gave you the best practices. I told you the way which is happening in the industry, but nobody, it is not 100% that business area can be only created as plants. I can create business areas as product also. That is not a problem. I can create my plants as my profit centers if required. So business areas and profit centers, those can be used interchangeably. I can use profit centers for my plants, and I can use my business areas for the products. But if you see the industry, what is being followed, you will find 90 or at least 80% of the companies, they are using business areas for locations and they are using products as profit centers. Okay, so if later on you implemented business areas for plants now, and after 2 years you say, no, I want to create my business areas as my products, that is a complete re-implementation.
Vikram, how we can differentiate a business area and a profit center?
See, those are just there for reporting requirement. So the way you want to generate the report, if you want to generate a report based on plants, if you want to generate a report based on your products, these two functionalities are provided by SAP. You can use a business area or you can use a profit center. But as I told you, normally we use business areas for locations and we use profit centers for products.
In service-based industries, do we have to maintain profit centers? Like that concept comes?
It can. In service industries also, you have different service lines, na? So for example, I have an IT company. In my IT company, I am having the SAP consulting as one area. I have business consulting as another area. I have, let's say, machine learning and artificial intelligence as a third area. And if I want to know what is my profitability for machine learning, what is my profitability for SAP consulting related projects, so definitely I need a service line there.
Thank you.
Hi, Vikram. Hello.
Yes.
This profit can be measured based on the product only or based on both the plant and product like that?
Both. So if you combine both, if you combine the report for business area as well as profit center, it will give you the report according to business area plus profit center. So okay. Business area is giving you plants and profit centers is giving you product. So if you want my profitability report based on combination of plant as well as my product, that can be achieved when you combine this business area as well as profit centers. Okay, is it clear now in your mind, this basic enterprise structure rules?
Yeah, I think I just wanted to add like a question here. So if you are creating this business areas for those many plants, you know, like Bangalore, Mumbai, Kolkata, and then if we plan to like, you know, like restructure those, that also we can do, correct? As long as we are not entering any information.
As long as you are not posted anything, you can do anything. Once you start posting, even if you made one posting, then if you change the structure, that will completely create the inconsistency in the system, right?
Yeah, thanks for
as long as you are not posted anything, you can make the changes whatever you want. But once it is productive, once it is being used at least for one day also, then if you are trying to make these changes, then what will happen is your one day information, whatever you have entered, that will create the inconsistency with the rest of the information. So if that is required, that is the reason this enterprise structure sign off takes months. It is not like I have completed enterprise structure in first week. Now you sign off so that I can proceed. Business will ask you n number of questions. They will ask you, okay, will I get this report? Will I get that report? You need to answer those questions. You need to have a lot of discussions with the customers. And based on that, they will finalize that, yes, this is exactly what the structure suits our business requirement, or we want to make some changes. Okay.
Yeah, thanks.
Vikram, can profit centers can also be segments?
Segments are one level above profit centers.
Okay.
So segments is in addition to profit center, if you want the third level, which means if I give the example, let's say you are manufacturing computers, laptops, and tabs. Within computers, let's say you are manufacturing for HP. You are manufacturing for Dell. Just let's assume this is, you are a third party company. You are not directly HP and Dell, but you are providing this manufactured computers to HP and Dell, and then they are sticking their stickers to sell in the market. Just for example. So the manufacturing the computers of HP, they are manufacturing the computers of Dell. Again, laptops also, they are manufacturing HP, Dell, let's say Samsung, right? And tabs also, they are manufacturing as HP and Dell, for example. So in this case, what will happen is, if you have a requirement that I want to do the report not only at the computers level, I want to do the report at HP computers, I want to do the report at Dell computers, I want to do the report at HP laptops. So what I can do is, I can create, let me show you the hierarchy, complete hierarchy. So what I can do in that case is, first level would be computers, laptops, tabs. So under computers, I have HP computer, I have Dell computer. Okay, same way, I have HP laptop, Dell laptop under my laptops area, and I have So what I can do in this case is, I can create this as profit center. HP computer is my profit center, Dell computer is my profit center, HP laptop is my profit center. So these are all my profit centers, right? These all are my profit centers. And at the end of the day, I not only want the report at the profit center level, I don't want the report at the HP computer level, but I also want to know all the computers together, how much profitability. So this computers, I can create it as a segment. So each and every profit center, whenever I create a profit center, I can assign it to the segment, so that at the end of the day, if I want to see the report at the segment level, at the computer level, whatever computers comes under this, whatever profit center comes under this computers, all those together will give me the computer level report. Okay, the use of segment is optional. Maybe we can take the same example. In our case, we'll take the same example. So we'll create a segment as computers, laptops, and tabs, and within this, we'll be creating different products, those as profit centers.
Yeah, thanks Vikram. So because why I got this doubt is current project which I am handling now, because they have a distribution company, they have implemented the segments as different like coffee, sugar, they have different segmental distribution. So that's why I got that.
Yeah, it would be good if you remember, or if you want to share, so that others are also benefited. So you are saying coffee,
Sugar and grains, you know, they do the distribution or different segments. Okay. There are around 10 segments there.
Okay, these are your segments, and then within this, what are your profit centers?
Different. They have different types of. I don't vaguely remember, because I saw this in during one of these. That's why I remember it. I'll tell you next session. I'll get that. So
no problem. Just for the understanding, because it would be always good if any one of you have worked on the real-time project, that will give them a lot of confidence that whatever we are discussing is very much matching with the industry. So let's take the same example, what you gave. So if I have Nescafe Brew as my cafes, so this, I want the report at the profit center level at this level, but ultimately at the segment level, if I want to know what is my overall business for coffee area, that I can generate at the segment level. Right, just for example. Okay, any questions? So what I'll do is tomorrow.
So I have a question.
Yes.
Hello. Yeah. So like maybe segments, I think segments are something that according to maybe accounting standards, segment is defined as something that which is having some critical impact, or maybe which is maybe a more than 10% profit, or there may be some definitions of segments. So at that level, like for example,
that is only for particular countries. Those are only for particular countries. Normally 98% of the time the segment that we are using is to meet our business requirements. So in this case, the example that I told you, this is a very practical requirement which can come from the business, and normally we use the segment concept to provide this level reporting.
Okay, so it can be a geographical location also, right?
If you want geographical, in that case, what you need to do in that case is you need to create this as Asia, you need to create this as Europe, and then within each of these areas, you will be having different countries.
Okay.
Right. So as I told you, it totally depends upon what is the business requirement. So in our case, in our example, we took the basis that we have. So it totally, that is the reason this enterprise structure is important. You need to first write what exactly they are looking for. So in your case, you are saying my business is not looking for the product. My business is not looking for the report at the product level. My business wants the report at maybe geographical level. So if geography is my level, then I need to create my profit centers according to geographies. Or maybe I can create my business areas as per the geography. So what I want to make the use, whether I'm using business area or profit center, that is up to the requirement that you get from the customer. Sometimes you will prefer to use business areas, sometimes you will prefer to use profit centers. Okay, in business area, you will not get this kind of hierarchy. The problem is in profit centers, at least you are getting this kind of hierarchy you can create. You can create profit center groups, you can create segments, you can combine multiple profit centers into one segment. Business area is simple. Business area is an independent object. You do not have the hierarchy in the business area. Okay, so those restrictions and plus and minuses ultimately will decide how you want to treat the enterprise structure. And it will require a lot of modifications also. It is not like you submitted and customer has agreed. Okay, maybe your senior consultant itself may not agree. He will say, no, let's create business areas because they have a particular requirement which is not matching with the profit center. So it requires a lot of brainstorming. Okay, but the concept will remain same. What we are trying to understand, the concepts. When you work in the industry, then based on the different requirements, you may need to change a little bit. But otherwise, the basic concepts will remain same. Business area, profit center. Why we need them? We need them to generate the reporting at the level below than the legal entity. So legal entity level reporting, I'm getting at the company code level. After that, if I want my product level reporting, if I want my location, geographical, anything, that I have to make the use of either business area or profit center. Normally business area is used for plants, and normally profit centers are used at product. But if my company says, I don't want the report at the product level, I want the report at some other area level, no problem, we will create those as profit centers. Clear?
Yeah, clear. And for example, like as we discussed, business area, business, like say for example, I have a plant which will support both, maybe multiple locations. So if, for example, in our case, like Bangalore, Mumbai, Kolkata, say, I have a business area which will support all three locations. So in that case, how do we?
No. So whenever, see, if you want the report at the business area level. Okay, so definitely in each and every transaction, you have to specify that this transaction is related to Bangalore, or it is related to Mumbai, or it is related to Kolkata. If you find that, okay, one of the transaction is relevant to all, okay, then also you have to split it. Otherwise, how will you get the report? If you are saying it is for all, then you will never get a report. Let's assume you are arranging a party and you involved the employees from Bangalore also, Mumbai also, and Kolkata also. And let's say the total expenses is, let's say, $10,000. Now you cannot say this $10,000 is I don't know which department it should go. Otherwise, you will not get an expense at that business area level. How will you generate the profitability? So what you need to do is, based on the number of employees who joined this meeting or this party, based on that, you have to divide it. From the system point of view, I can always create another business area as common, and I can book the postings in that common business area. But that is just for the temporary purpose, because if you keep on booking everything in common, then what is the point of having business areas? You will never get your financial reports at business area level. Temporarily, till the time you identify how many employees were participating in that meeting, you can book it in common, but later on from common, you have to make sure that it is divided to different business areas. So generate the balance sheet and profit and loss according to the business area.
Okay. Now, business area cannot be assigned, like, I mean, single business area cannot be assigned to multiple company codes, right? It is restricted to one company code.
No. Business area is not assigned to anything. Business area is an independent. So any company code can post in any business area. That is one of the base thing that you need to remember. It is also asked in the certification exam and very popular question in the interviews also. We'll talk about that in detail when we try to create those in the system. But just remember, business area is an independent object. If I create a business area Bangalore, I can use this business area in any company code. It will not stop me to use in any company code.
Okay.
Sorry?
Functional areas.
Functional area is very old concept. Functional area is very old concept. Previously, there was something called as cost of sales accounting, which is very, very, very rarely was used previously. But now with this advanced features, I don't think any company is using that cost of sales accounting. And that is not even considered as part of FI anymore. So if you see the certification books also and content also, nobody, there is a mention of functional areas.
Yes. Hello Vikram.
Yes.
So business area will be,
sorry, not able to hear you properly.
Business area means like we can say a trading partner also, right? Trading partner concept will be the same like business area.
No. Trading partner is a different thing. Where you heard about trading partner? Can you tell me what you know about trading partner?
Actually, currently I'm where I'm working, I'm using inter-division transactions where I use trading partner.
Trading partner is an optional concept. Trading partner will not come as area. Trading partner is called. So if these two companies, they want to do the transactions with each other. So if ABC India is selling something to US, or ABC US is selling something to ABC India, in that case, in order to do this intercompany transactions, we need to create a trading partner. And trading partner, which is required only when, this is optional, is required only for intercompany transactions. Okay, and in SAP, it is called as company, not the business area. It is called as a company. Okay. No need to worry for those who are completely new. I think most of you are completely new. If you have any questions, please go ahead. Don't hesitate to ask. And once we start doing this in the system, you will get more and more confidence. So I know for many of you, these are new terminologies. You may never have heard about the cost centers, profit centers, business areas. So it is not easy to digest all. But what I recommend is go through this video. I will try to share this video as soon as possible. Go through this video if required multiple times, and if you are finding any even after watching the videos, if you are not able to get anything, please ask in tomorrow's session, utilize tomorrow's session to ask the questions and make sure that everything is clear till now in order to understand the further topics. If you keep on like moving without understanding the previous topics, it may happen that you may not be able to understand the future topics at all, right? So keep on going through these videos. That is the reason the sessions are only conducted on weekends. You have a complete week to go through the videos. When we start the practicing, even you will be having the time to practice. Make sure that you are following that. If you don't follow, it would be too late. If you try after 2-3 weeks, now I will concentrate on SAP, it may happen too late that you are not able to digest the topics because you forgot to, or you were never able to understand the basic concepts. Okay, so let's close this session today and we'll meet tomorrow again with the further enterprise structure topics. As I told you, the best way we will be following in this batch is you will get a real feel of how the projects are undertaken. So we will create a proper document, and once the document is ready, then only we will go about configuring in the system. So next 2-3 weeks, not 2-3 weeks, I think maybe, yeah, at least around 2 weeks, we'll be only concentrating on the business requirements, and then we will start setup in the system so that you have a proper document available with you, what exactly you want to implement in SAP. Okay then, thank you all. See you tomorrow.
Thank you. Bye.